In this episode, we'll look closer at the temperature in polymer powder bed fusion. Next, we're looking at another schematic that goes into a little bit more detail about the temperature situation that we have inside of a build. This is a schematic that was drawn by a student at UW-Madison from the existing system, DTM 2500. It's already a quite old system. DTM is not in business anymore. But what you see here, again, are the components we've seen before. You see the laser, the CO2 laser. It's indicated that we're working in a nitrogen atmosphere, so that aging and powder degradation and degradation in general doesn't happen or is reduced. And then we see the powder reservoir on the left, on the right, and we see the part bed with the molten part inside. And so let's look a little bit at the heating elements that we have in addition to the laser. So we have two feeder heaters that are on top of the powder reservoirs, and we have a part bed heater. We also have heaters inside of here that we keep the part bed at an elevated temperature. And the laser is really just tipping the material over to actually melt. It's already at higher temperatures, and the laser doesn't provide the energy to move it from room temperature to melting point, but rather from a temperature just below the melting temperature to above the melting temperature to create the part. The powder reservoir is at 80 degrees C because once we deposit this powder on top of the part bed, if it would be at room temperature, it would really quench the part bed and cool it down rapidly. We want to avoid that. So we preheat the powder reservoir as high as we can, but we can't go higher than 80 degrees C because otherwise the particles would start to sinter and agglomerate and we couldn't actually perform a smooth coating operation anymore. So we need a temperature, elevated temperature inside. The laser is only really doing the last little bit of energy input that we can melt the part. And then the part is kept at this elevated temperature with the infrared heaters and heaters inside of here that the material doesn't start to crystallize and solidify. We want to do that controlled at a time during the cooling procedure. And because we work at elevated temperatures, we have a nitrogen atmosphere that enables us to reduce degradation and eliminate it sometimes. So here is another takeout from a PhD thesis from the University of Erlangen-Nuremberg, where you can see this is the part bed that's at elevated temperatures, for example, 166 degrees C for a nylon 12. And here you see the molten area, that shiny that we also saw in the videos. And here you see a partially coating of a new layer. So that was an interrupted print, just that you can see how different that looks and actually also that the molten part looks a little bit lower from the surface because it shrinks. So there's flow and other things. For the understanding of the polymer powder bed fusion process, it's important that we understand the melting and crystallization behavior. And we normally study that with DSC, differential scanning colorimetry. And what we get from that, we see in this schematic. It's a schematic for a measurement that was done on a nylon 12, PA12. And you see plotted in the schematic the heat flow as a function of temperature. And you see two curves. The red curve is a heating curve, and the blue is a cooling curve or a cooling process. So when we subject the nylon 12, we have it at room temperature, and we start to heat it up, we see that the temperature increases. And at some point, we need more energy to melt the semicrystalline structure that we have, the crystals that we have inside of the material, and we need energy. So we have an endothermic reaction. We need energy to actually melt it. And then once we're above melting temperature and we cool it down, we reduce the temperature. And at some temperature point below the melt temperature, the crystallization starts to happen, so the crystals start to form again, and that's an exothermic reaction where we have where heat is released during that process as we're cooling back to room temperature. If we had 100% crystalline material, the crystallization and the melting temperature would be at the same temperature, but with semicrystalline polymers, we have that effect of a hysteresis between the melt temperature and the crystallization temperature, and that's actually what we're using in this process. So the part bed temperature is above the crystallization temperature and below the melting temperature. We keep it with the infrared heaters, we keep it here at that in that temperature range. Now, the laser is then used to put additional energy into the system very locally and bring the material that's supposed to be melting above the melt temperature. So we follow this curve until we're here. Then, once the laser stops, we apply more colder powder on top of that. So the material cools down and it cools and it cools, and the infrared heaters are supposed to stop it from cooling to 80 degrees or a kind of mixed temperature between the part bed temperature and the reservoir temperature. So we want to stop the cooling at the same temperature, the part bed temperature that we've set before, because we don't want crystallization to start until the whole part or all the parts in the part cake are melted and fused together, and then we want to have a cooling that is performed at a low rate that we could get homogeneous crystalline structures and no shrinkage and other effects. So this is key in why a DSC measurement is essential for polymer powder bed fusion. It determines the part bed temperature that we have. For example, if the crystallization and melting peak would be closer together, it would become more tricky and find a good process window. And it explains how much energy we need the laser to provide to actually get it above melting and the whole temperature scenario that's required for that.